Sketches his own attempt at analyzing the material question in that book, it means the nature of art as a problem. Patočka says, quote, the present work is merely the first step in a program that is not proposed for short term. It seeks but to present an orientation on the idea of prehistory of theoretical thought without entering its realm as such in that book at that time. Between these two considerations, there lies, as a middle term, the consideration of human history, the philosophy of history. So it was penned in 1936 quite definitely. But let us turn to the solidity of the shaking. Patočka took this notion from Ernst Jünger, who used it for the designation of a special climactic experience of the soldiers in the trenches of the First World War. That was already said in the time. But the term is Jünger's. That is why we find it first of all in the sixth heretical essay, when Patočka emphatically describes how Europe, until then the bearer of universal civilization, loses its leading planetary role through its own devices. Patočka attempted here a sort of realization of Hölderlin's work, so beloved by Heidegger. It was also noted here. where Hölderlin says, but where there is danger, grows salvation too. It's my own translation, I had no time to look for the official. But where there is danger, grows salvation too. Just in the climactic moment of the clash by which the adversaries bury for good the civilization of which both are constituent parts, the individuals who realize the clash and face up to an almost sure danger of death experience as well, according to Patočka, something deep, a shock which by which that civilization could be saved. Patočka uses this climactic war experience intentionally in a similar way as Heidegger used the experience of deep boredom in the famous lecture, What is Metaphysics? As in Heidegger, the participants of the front line experience meet, in an acute way, the absolute nothing. And I think this is the first important point in understanding Patočka. He was always a little bit bothered by Heidegger, not with his main content of, the, of this ontological phenomenological philosophy, but with his behavior and so on and so on. And so he apparently changed this boredom, and instead of that he took this frontline experience. It's quite interesting. Nobody is noticing this.
I do.
Well, but you haven't mentioned that.
Yesterday I did.
Yesterday?
I mean, I did not speak of boredom, but I
well, so, to be sure, I think it's good to recollect Heidegger very shortly. So he says, the nothing is the complete negation of the totality of beings. Profound boredom, drifting here and there in the abysses of our existence like a muffling fog, removes all things and human beings and oneself along with them into a remarkable indifference. The anxiety that comes over us in a moment like this leaves us hanging because it induces the slipping away of beings as a whole. In the altogether unsettling experience of this hovering, where there is nothing to hold on to, pure Dasein, being here, is all that is still there. Dasein means being held out into the nothing. The nothing makes itself known, with beings and in beings expressly as a slipping away of the whole. In the clear night of the nothing of anxiety, the original openness of beings as such arises, that they are beings and not nothing. It was quoted not a text one sentence after another in the original. I chose several sentences to make it short, so it's a contents of about 3 pages or more. And so only through holding ourselves into the nothing, in which we are in each case already beyond the totality of anything that is, it means we are transcending beings, and it is only in this way that we can approach beings. So only holding ourselves out into the nothing, we can also adopt as transparent our own selves. And it is just here where Heidegger situates human freedom. And now it's a direct quotation. Without the original manifestness of the nothing, there is no selfhood and no freedom. And who read theoretical essays can already see what the similarity. But I shall show it shortly. In Patočka II, the frontline experience calls night to govern, night which reveals all positive interests, to speak with Heidegger, all beings, as impertinent. And in Patočka II, quotation, here the participants are assaulted by an absolute freedom from all the interests of peace, of life, of the day, unquote. Unlike these interests that Patočka calls relative, this experience of freedom is absolute, quotation. And, quote, the adversary is a fellow participant in the same situation. He is the fellow discoverer of absolute freedom with whom agreement is possible in difference, a fellow participant in the upheaval of the day of peace and of life lacking all peaks. And now the peaks here, or Patočka also said that the upswing is one of the main concepts in his understanding of what history proper is. And we shall see the quotations further on. So, the absolute freedom and the peace. And on the other hand, the interest of the day of peace and so on and so forth. But what are these adversaries to come to an agreement about? The adversaries originally striving to kill each other. Well, and now Patočka uses the concept of the force with capital F instead of Heidegger's Gestell in a way. So Patočka says a force, as Patočka send them to fight, a force born by the European tradition of modern times when, care for the soul, another main concept, the unique European way of life was no longer cultivated and Europe succumbed to the temptations of what it itself had created, the temptations of its scientific and technological power, to the limitless desire to possess, to rule, to command. This powerful force is, quotation, sending humans to death in order to assure others a day in the future in the form of progress. Unquote, and quote again, the day, life, peace, governed by means of death. Unquote. In the absolute experience of the frontline shock, the adversaries had a possibility to grasp that the mere satisfying of the needs of the day by which humans keep themselves alive in a more or less, more and more now more and more and more and more luxurious way is not that which makes a human being to be human, or better said, what makes a human being to be a European. So this is again already the counterposition of the life of mere sustenance with the life of the being, the absolute. According to Patočka, to be a European means to take part in the historical process of care for the soul that was started in ancient Greece simultaneously with the birth of politics and philosophy. It was the time when, quote, all the pillars of the community, traditions and myths were shaken, unquote. The up to now existing meaning of life was shattered. The shock that for Patočka was the birth of history proper made, quote, the special position of politics, unquote, possible. The reason of it is, quote, that political life in its original and primordial form is nothing other than active freedom itself, acting from freedom for freedom. The goal of striving here is not life for the sake of life, whatever life it may be, but only life for freedom and out of freedom, and it is understood, it means actively grasped, that such a life is possible. Philosophy simultaneously began to solve the question how such a life is possible and discovered that it is possible only with the ever-repeated, quote, radical questioning of meaning based on the shaking of the naive, directly accepted meaning of life, which is formed by the question of truth and drives the problematic nature, this problematic nature ever further, unquote. So now we really see what is the European heritage and what is the history and what was the Europe. Let's start. According to Patočka, we are today in a similar situation as it was at the dawn of history. Nevertheless, with the difference that then history was beginning, whereas today there is a danger that it could, as history proper, end. Furthermore, we are in the situation of being shaken, as they were. Not that we all would have the climactic frontline experience, that was only a drastic concretization of a situation the European humanity has been experiencing for already about two centuries. This is another important point I want to stress. The experience shaking Europe is the loss of support, originally supplied by religion, the gradual loss of the credibility of Christianity that was caused by the development of motives contained in Christianity itself. Patočka shows that these are the motives we have just mentioned, it means the radical questioning. These are, of course, also the motives through which Christianity has built Europe. But now, the radical questioning of meaning and truth has problematized Christianity's promise of the achievement of bliss in the infinity of the eternal life, as well as Varan, the infinitely good God. As far as this diagnosis is concerned, Patočka is in accord with Nietzsche and Dostoevsky. That is why, when analyzing the reasons which led to the First World War, Patočka can propose what he calls dogmatic nihilism. Quote, the shared idea in the background of the First World War was the slowly germinating conviction that there is nothing such as a factual objective meaning of the world and of things, and that it is up to strength and power to create such meaning within the realm accessible to humans. End of quote. Let us ask again what those advisories shaken by the experience of war should agree upon. Why should the solidarity of those shaken what should the solidarity of those shaken concern? And
I'm so welcome to this praise for me somewhere from
So we are asking what those adversaries are to agree upon. They have to grasp that there, in their climactic experience of annihilation, the force was overcome. The force with the capital F. The force that sent them there as its servants. Quote, the motives of the day which had evoked the will to war are consumed in the furnace of the front line if that experience is intense enough that it will not yield again to the forces of the day. Only if. Peace transformed into a will to war could objectify and externalize humans as long as they were ruled by the day, by the hope of everydayness, of a profession, of a career. So only if this experience is intense enough, so if these interests of everydayness are overcome. Now, however, comes the upheaval shaking the peace and its planning. Its ideas of progress indifferent to mortality. All visions of future life pale before the simple peak on which humans find themselves standing in the frontline experience. But again, this is only an example of this possibility of being shaped, standing vis-à-vis of nothing. The solidarity of the shaken adversaries should consist in, quote, not yielding again to the forces of the day, end of quote, in, quote, bringing about a transformation of their whole lives, their entire existence. The transformation of or conversion, as Potocka would say several pages later, consists in, quote, understanding what life and death are all about, and so what history is about. And it's necessary to be aware that we are speaking about history proper and the life of a real European. In understanding that, quote, history is the conflict of mere life, barren and chained by fear, with life at the peak, life that does not plan for the ordinary days of the future, but sees clearly that the everyday, its life and peace have an end. And this is, the history is the conflict, this, it is in italics, in Czech original, and Kovac forgot to put incorrect there. It's quite important to add. So, by passing through this night, through the experience with nothing, the shaken have to overcome the dogmatic nihilism, means Patochka. We quote it as above, as the main reason of the wars of the 20th century, because here they have a possibility to grasp that the true meaning of human life and of history is the life at the peak. And that it is necessary to ask for, quote, effectual, that it is not necessary to ask for effectual objective meaning of the world and of things. It's a quotation. It must suffice, say I, that the meaning is gained from the existential experience we cited above in the wording of Heidegger and from the frontline experience depicted by Patochka in the sixth heretical essay. He himself sees in this discovery the main merit of his own interpretation of the First World War in comparison with others. He says explicitly, quote, "All approach war from the perspective of peace, day and life, excluding its dark nuptial side. However, the idea that war itself might be something that can explain, that has itself the power of bestowing meaning, is an idea foreign to all philosophies of history." So far we have briefly reviewed what should the Shaken Adversaries agree upon. However, why does Patočka underline and demand their solidarity? So, what should they agree upon? That the life is possible in the level which is higher than the life of the mere sustenance, and this meeting with the experience of nothing is something which is meaningful in itself. And now there is a problem with this counterposition of the meaning of this experience in itself and the trouble with how to get out of the constant planning of the life of the sustenance, of the life of the everydayness and so on. And now there is a sort of trouble in Patočka's interpretation, and in fact I want rather strong criticize Patočka. Well, so it is necessary to keep in mind that after the First War, the Second followed, and then the Cold War lasted until Patočka's death. He refers to the letter as that half peace where opponents mobilize and count on the demobilization of the other. In this war, says Patočka, has its front line and its way of burning, destroying persons, robbing them of hope, dealing with them as with material for force being released. The front line here is the resistance to such demoralizing, terrorizing, and deceptive motives of the day. It is the revelation of their real nature. It is a protest paid for in blood which does not fall but rots in jails, in obscurity, in life plans and possibilities wasted, and which will flow again once the force finds its advantages. And therefore Patočka continues, quote, "It is to comprehend that here is where the true drama of freedom is being acted out. Freedom doesn't begin only afterwards, after the struggle is concluded, but rather has its place precisely within it." Here again, Kohart makes a funny, important error. He omits the word freedom. He says, and therefore, Patočka, it is to comprehend that here is where the true drama is being acted out, says Kohák. And Patočka says, it is here where the true drama of freedom is being acted out. Well, now Patočka's great problem is, how can the frontline experience acquire the form which would make it, a factor of history, was quoted many times here. Why it is not becoming that? His answer is, because it is the experience of all individuals projected individually, each today's summit from which they cannot but retreat back to everydayness, where they will inevitably be seized again by war in the form of forces planned for peace. And Patočka closes explicitly, quote, the means by which this state is overcome is the solidarity of the shaken. And these shaken are, Patočka noted, those who are able to understand what history is all about. So it is not enough to quote that they are those who know, because it's extremely important what they know. So that they know what history is all about, Patočka wants that they ought not to keep this understanding individually each to himself, but rather unite for an action that would change the world. And so here is again a sort of term. But let us recall that for Patočka at that time this motive is nothing new. Already in the time of the process of revival, it means the Prague Spring of 68, but especially under the impression of the student revolt in the West at that time, Patočka writes, the intelligentsia, and it means especially the technical intelligentsia accumulating already at that time in multitudes, so that they are already many, in that, quote, producing possibilities that touch both heaven and earth, and creating contact and relation between both of them, between heaven and earth, end of quote, should realize, the intelligentsia should realize, that their key position and grasp that, quote, to get organized into a body capable of actions, protests, and refusals could have a decisive influence as far as the rationalization and rationality of the society is concerned. And here, when you read it carefully, they are those who understand the process of history. End of quote. But at that time, Patočka doesn't yet present his work through philosophy of history, but rather discusses polemically with the materialist concept of history and tries to wake up the intelligentsia to participate in the hopeful political process at the end of the 60s. By rationality, he means here, after all, the rationally grounded morality of Kant's categorical imperative. This imperative, understood by the mass of the intelligentsia and applied in political praxis, would lead to the, quote, reign of the spirit, end of quote. No wonder that the naivete of this idea became clearly manifest soon after the occupation of the Czechoslovakia by the armies of the Warsaw Pact. However, it is interesting that Patočka kept the concept of solidarity in this way for the philosophy of history of the 70s, of his philosophy of history in the 70s, and comes with a similar demand at the end of the sixth heretical essay. Quote, solidarity of the shaken can and must create a spiritual authority, become a spiritual power that could drive the warring world, the warring world to some restraint, rendering some acts and measures impossible. It was also quoted several times here. But it is obvious that for the dissident opposition in the 70s and 80s, the concept of the solidarity of the shaken had a principal importance. It was doubtless one of the main motives leading to the formation of the protest movement Charter 77, And it continued partly to resonate even in the manner in which the totalitarian regime was displaced in Czechoslovakia in 1989. Was the solidarity of the shaken then as naive as it appeared? But on the other hand, the question becomes urgent. What the concept of the solidarity of the shaken being understood was, or has the concept of the solidarity of the shaking being understood and realized sufficiently? What is the position in Patočka's philosophy? What is its concept of the solidarity? What is its position in Patočka's philosophy of history? It is certainly necessary to analyze the contradiction which is apparently striking in what we cited until now. Let us notice that on one hand, when Patočka formulates what is the main content of the climatic frontline experience, he underlines that, quote, the sacrifice loses its relative significance. Rather, it is significant solely in itself. It is the understanding that here something has already been achieved. Something that is not the means to anything else, but rather something above and beyond which there can be nothing. End of quote. This is exactly why Patočka can say that this experience is nothing, is something absolute. Quote, war can show that among the free, some are capable of becoming gods, of touching the divinity, of that which forms the ultimate unity and mystery of being. And this is the mystery of being which also Václav Havel is referring to. On the other hand, Patočka wants that this experience of being is, as I quoted above, something, quote, that has itself the power of bestowing meaning, end of quote. And this power should be absolute. This absoluteness would oppose the dogmatic nihilism that concedes only a relative meaning and radically negates the possibility of an absolute one. In this manner, the frontline experience would have meaning not solely in itself, but it would bestow meaning also to the future. It means it would be means to something else. Namely, it would be, quote, a certain prospect, this is a quote, a certain prospect of reaching the ground of true peace from the war endangered by peace, end of quote. Patočka derives this prospect, this hope, based on the supposition of the solidarity of the shaken, from his rather metaphorical statement, that the absolute meaning bestowing experience meant that the adversaries, quote, have thus touched that which lasts in everything and forever, because it is the source of all being and thus divine, end of quote. So it is, in a way, something absolutely solid, but on the other hand, it's nothing. It's being, which we described in these experiences, either in Heidegger's boredom or in Patočka's frontline. Patočka devotes the whole third essay to meditation on meaning and its problematicity under the title "Does History Have a Meaning?" The reason for this is that when he agrees with Nietzsche and Dostoevsky that Christianity today is not able to be the source of the meaning of things, human acts and history, and when he refuses the modernistic concept of history as the big story of progress, and when he at the same time does not agree with dogmatic nihilism, then an aporia arises, a problem. Arises and Patočka is obliged to explicitly solve it. To sharpen this aporia, this problem, we note Patočka's citation of Wolfgang Weichselder, who argues that, quote, meaningfulness is never possible as something individual. Every individual meaning refers to a global meaning, every relative meaning to an absolute meaning, end of quote. However, absolute meaning is not available, as Patočka quite clearly shows. All attempts up to now to find an absolute meaning were in vain. All were necessarily metaphysical or religious and thus illusory. In this hopeless situation, Patočka draws attention to Heidegger's analysis of anxiety quoted above. In the third essay, he quotes directly this Heidegger's passage. The passing through a total loss of meaning presents, quote, the discovery of being beyond all existence and their significance, the being that is nothing existent but rather appears from the standpoint of what is as mere nothing and none, mere wonder. The wonder that there is being at all. End of quote. The possibility to make that step back from all that is, this is quote from Heidegger's book, and humans make this step back, the possibility to make that step back from all that is, and humans make this step back all the time without explicitly realizing that, makes human life what it is, a constant distancing from entities and the possibility in this space and in virtue of it to adopt a stance toward them. And let us add also the stance toward oneself. This adopting stance toward things and toward oneself is, to speak with Patočka, looking for the meaning of the things and of ourselves in the framework of, to speak with Heidegger, our being interested in our existence, in how we are. And it is also what can be called human transcendence, human transcending, and in, only in through this transcending, as I wanted to say now, can we understand whatever and can we understand ourselves as being human. Whereas in the sixth essay, Patočka says directly that the passage through the climactic frontline experience can bestow meaning. Here we see clearly that the meaning, quote, the meaning to which we might perhaps return will no longer be for us simply a fact given directly in its integrity. It means, end of quote, it means it shall not be absolute. It, quote, will never be simply given or won once for all, end of quote. Nevertheless, Patočka resolutely refuses to call this meaning with Nietzsche a relative meaning. It would mean for Patočka to succumb to nihilism, which understands the loss of meaning in the climactic experience, quote, as an antinomy of being and meaning, the experience of the emergence of being would be at the same time the experience of the utter meaninglessness of what is. End of quote. Instead of accepting this evident consequence and philosophically coping with it, and I shall try to show that he would not need to change much in his concept of the philosophy of history. So instead of accepting this evident consequence, Patočka makes an evasive maneuver which seems to indicate that, in spite of his best effort to avoid the remnants of metaphysical thought, he was in the end unsuccessful in overcoming that. To solve the problem, he redefines the meaning of the concept of meaning. Quote, actually, we are dealing only with the uncovering of meaning which can never be explained as a thing, which cannot be mastered, deleted, grasped positively and dominated, but which is present only in the seeking of being. The basis of this meaning is the concealment of what is as a whole, as the foundation of all openness and all uncovering. Thus it is this mystery that expresses itself in the shaking of naively accepted meaning. Thus the shaking of naive meaning is the genesis of a perspective on an absolute meaning. End of quote. Being is now made to the seed of a new meaning in the quotation marks, which can be now called absolute in quotation marks. Quote, the being that is nothing existent, but rather appears from the standpoint of what is as mere nothing, mere wonder, the wonder that there are beings at all. I repeat this quotation because this is the absoluteness which Patochka is. And what is the use of this perspective on an absolute meaning? Obviously, to fulfill the demand of Vaishnava, it means that every individual meaning refers to a global meaning, every relative meaning to an absolute meaning. However, this would mean, after all, that every relative meaning is absolute, and it would completely exclude the possibility of what we experience every day, namely, that something that appears relatively meaningful turns out to be meaningless. That is why Patochka must, together with Vaishnava, add that this absolute meaning is a problematic meaning. And Patochka continues, quote, passing through the experience of the loss of meaning means that there emerges a new relation, a new mode of relating to what is meaningful. That meaning can arise only in an activity which stems from a searching lack of meaning, as the vanishing point of being problematic, as the indirect epiphany, direct epiphany of the meaningfulness. The last word, epiphany, reminds us that Patochka's philosophy of history also wants to overcome Christianity in the form of dogmatic theology, to overcome the Christianity which, as we stated with Nietzsche, has led to European nihilism. The letter threatens to cause the end of history proper. Certainly not the end of development in time, but rather the end of the upswing which started in ancient Greece and gave birth to both political life, namely the life acting from freedom, for freedom, and philosophical life, as the again and again repeated radical question of meaning based on the shaking of the naive, directly accepted meaning of life. In connection with the overcoming of Christianity, we can also understand why Patochka calls this problematicity of meaning a conversion, metanoē, metanoesis. At the same time, it is obvious that this conversion is the same as the solidarity of the shaken. Quote, the possibility of a metanoesis of historic proportion depends essentially on this. Is that part of humanity which is capable of understanding what was and is the point of history, and which is at the same time ever more driven by the entire positioning of present-day humanity at the peak of technoscience, to accept this possibility for meaninglessness? So is this part of humanity also capable of the discipline and self-denial demanding by a stance of uprootedness, in which alone a meaningfulness, both absolute and accessible to humans, because it is problematic, might be realized? End of quote. Here in this sentence, there is so many things to be explained that we would need a week for that. You must note that he says here something which is contradiction which is not possible to get rid of. So, uprootedness in which allows a meaningfulness, both absolute and in connection with accessible to humans, contradict each other severely, become, because it is problematic, yeah? So the meaningfulness which is absolute and it is accessible to meaning because it is problematic. So in this way, Patočka wants to overcome this aporia of the absoluteness of that meaning which is bestowed by the understanding of the nothingness and so on. So on one hand, and on the other hand, he wants that in this main European care for the soul, which is the again and again repeated problematizing and questioning the situation and so on. So in this way, Patočka wants to overcome this paradoxical understanding of the meaning. That's why I said that he makes the maneuver of defining meaning of the concept of meaning in a special new way. And so let us ask once more and for the last time, why does Patočka mean to connect that which cannot be connected? Namely, on the one hand, the sense of uprootedness and of of the absolute freedom that, as we presented above, has meaning solely in itself. Then, on the other hand, the absolute meaning in the vanishing point of problematicity. As it is also interesting, on the one hand, the meaning is itself solely in this climactic experience, be it the climb or whatever, water, whatever. And on the other hand, the meaning in the vanishing point of absoluteness and so on. After all, Socrates, whom Patočka remembers time and again as a prototype of a philosopher who designed a new way of life consisting in the discovering of meaning in the seeking, this is a quotation, discovering of meaning in the seeking which flows from its absence, and of course, did not need any absolute vanishing point. After all, it was, according to Patočka himself, only Plato who transformed the original Socratic philosophical seeking into metaphysics by teaching forms which ought to bring, quote, a definitive clarity and a definitive explanation of things, end of quote. And so brought philosophy on the path which ultimately led to the present time nihilism. One of the possible answers to this question, it means the question of why does Patočka need to connect that which cannot be connected, could be Patočka's concern that if we would be content with the relative bestowing meaning on the meaningless, then, quote, the origin of all meaning, its ground zero, would be in us, and in our power, end of quote. And we would be again in the trap of metaphysical subjectivism. However, I think there is no such danger any longer. After all, the discovery of an absolute freedom in the shattering of all meaning was made, to be sure, in the awareness of our being radically finite. And likewise, to speak about responsibility as, quote, a freedom of letting being to be what it is, not distorting being, end of quote, is after all possible only for a finite being. It is a being which is aware of its finitude and dependent on that which is. It knows, such a being, knows that it must responsibly repeat and improve its attempts of uncovering what is up until it responds to all objections and sufficiently proves that what it shows is no longer distorted and therefore true. It was an attempt in one sentence to say what is responsibility, yes? So this being must responsibly repeat and improve its attempts on uncovering what is up until it responds to all objections and sufficiently proves that what it shows is no longer distorted and therefore true. It's also in a way a short description of what Plato in the Republic means by the dialectic, but it's not story. All this Patočka, of course, knows. In the first theoretical essay, he says clearly, in the anxiety of freedom, quote, human being is confronted with its own bare being here, means Dasein, with the being as that which only is affirmed when the all common contexts of meaning are shattered. With being here as the open place, Offenesteller, he wrote this in German, it's the second handwriting. So with being here as an open place where an existent can be present. So Dasein, it means to be a human being, is a sort of open place where an existent can be present, where we can meet with whatever it is. Patočka works here obviously in Heidegger's concept of das offene, the open place. Already in his texts on the asubjective phenomenology in the beginning of the 70s, Patočka called it the field of manifestation, the field of phenomenalization. A phenomenon is not mediated by any existent, be it of objective or subjective art, it means us, but rather by being, now in capital B. That is why it manifests itself immediately, directly, but only so far as we are in our life open for it. And it is up to us to cope with it. Well, this last was my, the end of all was just before. So the quotation is, a phenomenon is not mediated by any existing, be it of objective or subjective art, but rather by being. That is why it manifests itself immediately, directly, but only so far as we are in our life open for it. But in conclusion, I would dare to say that Patočka's vision of history from the point of view of the night is correct, but that Patočka doesn't live up to his own concept of history when he says that the solidarity of the shaking could be, quote, capable of leading humankind out of war into a true peace, end of quote. On the contrary, it is possible to agree with him when he says, yet the problem of history may not be resolved, it must be preserved as a problem, end of quote. It means the conflict of new life with life as a being. It means the conflict of life of mere sustenance with the life in upstream cannot be resolved. And if it were resolved, it would, speaking to Patočka, mean the end of history proper, and it would mean to come back to the prehistorical situation where the humankind cared only for the mere sustenance in the big households of the historical
civilizations.
Yeah. Well, I think it's a lot of to add, but I'm sure it's difficult to make it in the show.
Because we started the discussion that there is some connection between highly philosophic, speculative or philosophical analysis of Jan Patočka and then such a profane thing as struggle for human rights. That there is here, that there are here those who then signed Charter 77. I think that Patočka maybe was the only one who could understand himself in this way. But still, they seemed to join and then they created something. And look, when Patočka himself speaks about Socrates, he likes to quote from Cicero, from Tusculan Disputations, and quote from Patočka, from Cicero quoted by Patočka, Socrates called philosophy down from heaven and placed it in cities and introduced it even in homes and drove it to inquire about life and customs and things good and evil. I have to confess myself in front of all of you, I'm an inauthentic existence. I somewhat need specific relationship to absolute meaning. I was also thinking, do Christians really need to be assured again and again that absolute meaning is available, what the availability of absolute meaning is? I don't think that they go to church and they see the absolute meaning there and they believe that it's available. They have some strange habits, maybe, and habits that are related to certain part of the population. I would like you just to get into this question. What is the transition then between this and, motivation of, I would say, non-philosophical human rights defenders that are not part of?
No, the question is quite clear and the answer is not so complicated. You see, this struggle for the human rights belongs, of course, to this conflict between the real life for the sustenance and the life in the peak. And the struggle for the human rights is, of course, from the part of those struggling for them. Is the life over the mere sustenance, because they are struggling for something which for them belongs or is a part of what they of what they understood what is history and life about to live in the peak, yes, and that's exactly why it is a struggle, because they of course are struggling with those who do not want to respect human rights and so on. So this is very well covered by these abstract and I agree quite complicated constructions. But what is my task and effort to, in a way, understand these complicated constructions which Patočka made so densely in the short text. Well, so it doesn't have to...
I think it's much more serious than that. And it becomes very serious when the solidarity of the shape comes.
Serious, then what?
You have more trouble than you have admitted. That's what I mean. It's when the solidarity of the shapen becomes the paralysis of the totally numb. And I think where World War I is an interesting case is that it led into European political space that was totally incapable of standing ground. We heard this morning the interesting case of 1530. And what we admire in the Indians is that they were at least able to fight for their sustenance. But what do you do? The Indians in Latin America. What you admire in nature is the adaptation, the call to arms, if I can use that sentence, the ability to stand and fight for your life. But the terrible thing about the 20th century in Europe is all those millions that went to the gas chambers without necessarily doing what perhaps the Indians would have done in their own land. I don't want to push this too far, but I think where the solidarity of the shaken becomes the paralysis of those who are totally out, you know, that's a huge problem. No.
Well, of course, this is a huge problem, but you have to sort it out. You see, what followed the First World War was still a struggle of this European spirit, because it could happen, and it happened that it was temporarily not successful, and that's exactly the problem in Patočka's interpretation, that he seems to ask to get out of this troublesome situation of struggle where the interests of sustenance and everyday peace and so on are overcoming these overweighting this understanding what is going on about in history. So on one hand, the real peace would be established, and on the other hand, he understands that it is an impossible desire. Yes. And of course, we see that even now, this main European trade was not lost. Yes, people are still struggling for the human rights, and governments are in a way solidarity. Have solidarity in effort to keep the peace in the world and to oppose such extremist attempts as, I don't know, the Korean atomic bomb and so on. So the spirit of Europe is being held even after the end of European supremacy, which Patočka describes and so on. So a sort of heritage is still here, and history hasn't finished, yes, hasn't ended. So, I'm losing the thread.
No, I just wanted to follow my question. We all agree that there is a distinction between bad life and good life. That's Aristotle that articulated this very clearly, that good life sense is a political life. And he summarizes that there must be, so that we can see polis being created as Sunteke original, some sort of agreement between those who become citizens, what the difference between good life and bad life is, so that citizens are ready to fight for the freedom. So my question would be, okay, for solidarity of the shaken, We need some concept of plurality. We need at least two. Can be solidarity of the shaker with one person only? Solidarity is relationship. There must be some relationship and space and maybe some synteke agreements between these two or three or four that good life, life with his peaks, is better than just to sit at home and try to serve as a slave the better life. And how this synteke can be agreed with when I'm afraid many would be almost rejected from the agreement. Those who believe in absolute sense might be already disqualified because they don't have the right understanding of history. How they can understand together?
I don't know, because it's much deeper, I come to my mind. Because I think sometimes we also must make the world to have the peace. So I think it's this personal engagement of everybody here to arrive to this, because without this we cannot like arrive to that point. You know?
But I don't understand your question now.
What is the basis of what is the sort of understanding between those who should understand as a part of the solidarity of the shaker? How they can understand together? And obviously you have those philosophers of history, but then I'm just thinking about all others who got the Patočka's message and stepped into this space. They have some sort of intuitive maybe understanding of the difference between freedom and non-freedom. They had also understanding what the Socratic appeal is, to live in unity with yourself. If you lie to yourself, it's worse than somebody else lies to you, because the liar is always with you, goes everywhere. So these are things that I think are understandable, but how this is connected with this quite complicated concept of philosophical history.
Well, perhaps I answer around the corner. Patočka died very soon after Charter 77 started. And I think it is possible to say that especially Charter 77 was a sort of a very, very perfect example or realization of what we was asking for. And the solidarity, of course, would there be between the previous communists and the Christians and other people from the anti-communists and so on. And they both understood that it's meaningful to risk their lives and perhaps not lives anymore, but their everydayness and so on. And that it is this, that there is the right freedom. So I still don't understand why you all the time miss the connection between the theoretical scheme and the concreteness, problems of the situation in the history.
No, I think that the simple answer is that you understand that you must, because of something, you must to do that. And in the same time, there are some others who are doing the same. It's like this European process, because there was not any voting before this coming more than 15 member states. Because when they feel that they can go the same way, they go. And then before that, they should explain each other why. And then I think that the others who are not shaken are very often place questions which are not natural, which are very artificial. And what I want to say before your question is that practically I think the reasoning is that this industrial revolution, because before industrial revolution there were much more independent people than afterwards. Practically independent people became dependent, and that's why this white civilization cannot defend itself without politics, without some leaders of the country, and so on. But in the end, it's good.
Yes, there is someone at the back.
Yes,
further
question you have asked.
Really?
I'm quite dead.
Exactly what Patochka wrote when he asks for the metanoia. He asks for that intelligentsia, and he wants really thinks about what's the matter and looks for what to do in the situation where it is not clear what to do.
Yes, go on.
And that life that we are trying to experience right now is a life for better hope, better future of the whole world. So I think the chance which we are getting right now is a chance for all of us, for all human beings. And this is not my idea, this is what Václav Havel said. That is a word. And that word must continue. And I believe it is the word of love, the word of truth. And that truth that comes deeply from within us needs to be expressed. And it needs to be expressed in an absolute freedom. And I believe that freedom is not what is given by the state or by an outside world. That freedom comes from within. It comes from inside all of us. So it's that place inside each one of us that we can access, and we can access it through our own deep decision. Yeah, when we say, yes, I can have this freedom. But that possibility to have this freedom is related to my own decision, my own free decision. To say yes to this way of life, because it's the life in truth.
You say it quite nicely, but you have to see also that this freedom, which I also spoke about it, is a sort of absolute, and it means that it is a freedom also to make evil, to steal and to do whatever evil things. And it is also up to everybody to decide. And the trouble for the theoreticians is where to find the reason for decide oneself for the responsibility, for the responsible life. It's not a simple question. Exactly because the problem with the absoluteness of meaning and with the problem with the Christian, which is not available anymore in a way, and so on and so on. So it is really the problem which Patočka is urgently trying to solve. He's struggling to solve it, and he is not ready with that. Where to ground this decision for the good, if you want to have it like that.
One word, and that word is conscience. Conscience.
Each individual. Well, everybody has conscience and makes terrible things.
Mm-hmm. I think it's something that comes from your inner voice that tells you this is
correct. But if it were only like this, there would be no evil in the world. Why there is so many evil people?
There is one question. If you can agree that there were created two states already according to her wisdom or her manual. It was Uruguay and Paraguay by Jesuits. In the same time the Jesuits were forbidden in the Central Europe. Could you agree with this?
Patočka really uses very strongly the experience from the First World War, and many things that happened between the First World War and the moment when this text was written. What is disturbing is that obviously the way how, and I think the argument in favor of Patočka, that politics as it was shaped after the First World War was somewhat not sensitive enough to certain phenomena that were existing. You can think about all plights of those who were exposed to totalitarian governments, all these unknown victims of famine in Ukraine, and all what Stalin and Hitler were doing in what now is being called by one American author the Bloodlands. I think that Patočka, you know that better than I do, before he, or in the same time he was writing practical essays, he was very fascinated by Solzhenitsyn. And Solzhenitsyn was the one who gave voice to people whose main punishment was to become unknown, voiceless, invisible, suffering somewhere, rotting somewhere. So I think Patočka's argument would be much stronger if his concept of philosophical history would be seen in action and pointing on time to these things that were not registered enough by architects of the world, actually state of being shaken. You have it in the foundational documents of the United Nations that the whole organization is created because mankind was shocked by whatever. But you know, was it shocked enough, and was it shocked in a way that solidarity of the shaken became a real factor in history?
Your comments lead me to ask a question that has been rattling around in my mind, and this might be the time to raise it. Thinking of the passing of time between when Patočka was writing and now, but especially the passing of time since the creation of those documents after the Second World War and the shock that engendered those documents, out of that came these declarations of human rights and covenants and constitutions and etc. And we've been talking about human rights and human rights. Now, I think we're living in this moment, this dispensation, where what Potocka says about the need to not live simply in routines and habits where there are pre-givens and certainties that we take for granted, we're living in a dispensation where the language of human rights and the issues of human rights have entered the mainstream of what most people take for granted as pre-givens and certitudes. They arose from experiences of shakenness, but we now live in a time where, and I hear this from colleagues of mine who say, do you really take this human rights stuff seriously anymore? Because, they say that because we've entered a time where that language and those values and those principles and those orientations have, for many people, come to be part of this secure, routine, pre-given certitudes. So there's this strange irony which has emerged, which is that only through the fragility of the meaning of the foundation of human rights that is recognized in the experience of shakenness now can the validity of human rights be reaffirmed. And that's different from the title of Potocka was writing,
yeah.
I think. What do you think about that?
Well, just one comment to your note that why the United Nations and so on, you know, sort the problem of the peace and so on. Well, but this is, the question is put in a wrong way, from the wrong angle. It is put from the angle which I am not agreeing with Potocka when he says that the solidarity of the shaken could bring us to the could bring about the real peace. Yes. So you want a real peace, but there is no real peace, and there will never be. That's the meaning of his philosophy of history. That the real peace, in a way, is not possible. And but on the other hand, he. It is possible to quote him where he wants that, yes, but it is contradicting the main spirit of his theory of the history of the philosophy of history. That's my argument.
Yeah. You are, Eric, to say, you want to say something?
Yes. I apologize in advance, but I don't want to be very coherent because I want to respond to what she said and said and you said, and so. And also I prefer to start with a simple sentence before I sound very coherent. But I think it's to some extent a lot of matter of interpretation of what do you mean by saying freedom and conscience and inner voice and truth. And all that, because I don't agree with you, in the way that you said you responded to the conscience and inner voice debate by saying, well, but people are also free to steal or free to do
bad things.
Sorry?
Bad things.
Yeah, to do bad things, to steal, to kill. I don't think people are free to steal or to kill. And if you bring it back to the debate also to the hate speech and freedom of expression, for example, you are free to say what you want, but in some countries you are not even free to say that. In the US you can deny Holocaust. You can't deny Holocaust in France, for example, without a consequence, legal consequence. And so if you are not even free to say something, for me, you are not free to kill or to steal. And you said there are people in the group who do bad things, but they also have conscience. No, I think if you have conscience, then you don't do bad things. So I think it's also playing with words and how to be interpreted. What is for me conscious, what is for you conscious, what is for you freedom, and say.
So. But it was no play with the words. I attempted to show what Potocka means by freedom here. Mm-hmm. Yes. And it has nothing to do with what the state allows you to do or not. It should be really from but then if this thing is really so absolute, it cannot be held up on some other absolute meaning in the relation of power. That's the problem.
Okay.
Very, very briefly at the end. You have raised several times the important point from Potocka about whether Christianity or religion or more widely metaphysics can play any role today, whether it has already played all the role it can. I think a very important challenge in our world to all people who call themselves religious or people of faith, and after all that does encompass the vast majority of human beings today, is how we can reformulate the message of faith today. I think that Christianity definitely carries a strength through the example of Christ, faith in Christ, but at the same time, there is a challenge to reformulate that in our world. And in some ways, I hear that in Protestant history. It's not as if, you know, this is gone once and for all, so you have to find something new. It's also a question of how do we reformulate the wisdom of 2,000 years ago in our world today. And I think that's a task of metaphysics, of theology, of philosophy, of concepts.
And now we have Jesuit apprenticeship.
Just as an addendum to Henrik's point, the last sentence of the fifth heretical essay is a very provocative one, where he says, the real question is, is it possible for historical humans to embrace history? Now, this gets to Henrik's point. How did we become historical beings? Through the Greeks and through the Jewish and through the Christian shapings and openings of the abyss. That's how we became historical. That is the basis of the experience of becoming historical humans. Now, you bring all of those discoveries and you domesticate them and bring them into the realm of pre-givennesses and certainties, then the question of how can you have historical beings living in the dispensation that have been opened by all of that, who have domesticated all of those meanings and insights, are they going to be able to embrace history by reopening and rediscovering in the way that Henrik just articulated, I think.
And to embrace history, of course, means here to understand what is history all about, and it means to understand this ontological freedom vis-à-vis nothing and so on. And in this way, it's necessary to also understand that Patochka calls the essays heretical, and he means it quite seriously. And you see it when he uses, as I mentioned, the words conversion, metanoia. He means really to overcome this, what you mentioned was functioning 2,000 years. Because at the beginning of that were also used these words, yes, metanoia, conversion. Mm-hmm. So when he asks for metanoia, he means something quite terrible. He needs to be able to cope with the problems without leaning upon the Christian concepts. Yes, that's why. Because otherwise, he would be enough to use Kant's postulates. Kant already had faced this problem, and he solved it in a well-known way, yes? And that's exactly what is Nietzsche and Dostoevsky criticizing, that it is not possible to solve it like Kant, yes? Patochka goes one step further and speaks explicitly about metanoia, which means to, and so on, understand what is history all about, and so on. So, well, I'm sorry, I must
did
some.
Okay, let's leave it with a big question mark.
Yeah.
and after lunch only the leftovers of the seminar. First, very important one, it will be some humor or maybe lighter the conversation about dissent and all this stuff, and then we will close it, and there will be a more party.